forum looking after the training, the relationship for the forum. And today's topic is something very close to my heart. Even I wanted to have so much information about it. And I'm excited because two very good speakers today are attached with us as our knowledge sharing partners. And they'll be sharing some discrete point related to the topic. And in the end, we'll be expecting some questions, queries coming from our participant, and our speakers will be more than happy to take up all those questions. So let's start with it. Why this topic, intellectual property right, is so important for our startups. As a startup, we all know it's a company or a project which is undertaken by any entrepreneurs who are seeking development, validation, a scalable business model. While entrepreneurship refers to all new businesses, including your self-employment businesses that never intend to become registered. But startups refer to new businesses that intend to grow large beyond the solo founders. So at the beginning, startups face a lot of uncertainties and they have high rate of failure. But a minority of them, they do go on to become successful and influential. And some startups we have seen, they have even become unicorns, right? So there are so many problems that creep in with startups, when they venture into it. Certain things we have seen is lack of finances, poor business plannings are there, lack of proper marketing strategies, lack of good dedicated team who could work with them, and fierce competition definitely with the existing companies. So amongst all this, the question is, what is intellectual property rights? So just by definition, I can say that it is anything and all rights associated with intangible assets, which is owned by a person or a company, and it is protected against use without a consent. So, but our speakers today, they'll be the best people to tell you everything about intellectual property, right? So let me introduce you directly without taking much of the time. Let me introduce our first speaker, Ms. Mini Gautam. And she has been recognized as one of the business world top 40 lawyers under 40. That's quite commendable, Miniji. And she's the founder of Arthavat Law Offices. She's a subject matter expert with the MSME businesses. And she's also vice president legal at Indian Chamber of Commerce in the Slovak Republic. She advises many startups and companies in the MSME sector, along with bigger businesses, conglomerates on regulatory, statutory, and compliance issues. She has worked as a legal advisor for the pharmaceuticals and healthcare divisions, education, fintech, financial services sectors, and many, many more. So welcome, Miniji. Welcome
so much
for today's session. Please. And our second speaker today is Mr. Ketan Makhija. He's a partner at Link Legal, New Delhi based, specialized in M&A, joint ventures and private equity, strategic alliance and investments, and corporate restructuring. He has led numerous large ticket sized M&A transactions and also advises on corporate and commercial agreements, intellectual property, private equity, and compliances. With practice qualifications in both India and UK, he is also a registered insolvency resolution professional and a qualified company secretary for UK, continental Europe, Africa, and Southeast Asia. Today our speakers have a plethora of experience, knowledge in their field. So without wasting much of your time, let's go with the speakers, Mini and Ketan. This virtual dais is all yours. Please go ahead and take up the podium.
Sure. Thank you so much, Preeti and Ketan. I mean, I'm sure Ketan will be courteous enough to allow me to go first. So I'll just thanks. So I'll just give a yeah. So thank you so much, Preeti, and thanks for the introduction. We are both very thankful. So Ketan and I both work with a lot of startups and MSME companies, and recently we have been working with many startups. So I think a lot of the legal compliance, I think Titi, you have very rightly said that for startups, they don't, the priority for any startup is the product and marketing the product. And I think that is where the time, attention, and most of the energy goes for most startups. So legal and compliance, it really takes a kind of a backseat, because I think 70 to 80% of the clients that come to us, it is probably after they have received some kind of a legal notice or something has gone wrong. Because for most business owners, I mean, I was very surprised to hear one business owner tell me a few days ago, who has been in business for more than 20 years, that contracts are not enforceable in India. And I said, what are you saying? So sometimes there are very basic things that people don't understand. So and of course, because if somebody asks me to questions on tech, then I will not be able to answer it. So our roles are very specialized, I think, and it is the same with legal and compliance. And I think a very dangerous precedent nowadays is again, lots of startups have come to me and said that we have copy-pasted the documents, with employees, with terms of use, appointment letter. Everything is going on copy paste. And then again, the problem with that is that that has not been customized to your particular needs, nor has when a lawyer applies their mind to your particular commercial requirements and gives advice, then the kind of output that comes and copy pasting from Google, it is again completely different. Again, if you the nearest example is like when we go to a doctor and we say we Google this, and they'll be like, don't try to medicate yourself.
Absolutely,
So
absolutely.
so that same issue is we face here as lawyers as well. There are a lot of people come and say that we have we know this, but then when you actually come to a situation where sometimes you think that, okay, what is the cost involved? Many people think that we will bear the cost, we will देखेंगे, बट व्हाट समटाइम्स यू डोंट रियलाइज इज दैट व्हेन लीगल थिंग्स गो साउथ देन द कॉस्ट कुड बी ह्यूमंगस. द अंडर मेनी लॉज द पेनल्टीज प्रिस्क्राइब्ड आर सो ह्यूज, एंड ऑन अ कॉन्ट्रैक्ट देयर इज नो एंड टू द अमाउंट ऑफ लॉस दैट कैन एक्चुअली हैपन इफ योर कॉन्ट्रैक्ट हैज नॉट बीन इन्फोर्स, इफ योर कॉन्ट्रैक्ट इज नॉट प्रॉपर. बिकॉज अगेन, इफ यू रिलाय ऑन अ परचेज ऑर्डर, यू रिलाय ऑन अ पीस ऑफ पेपर, एंड इट जस्ट हैज वेरी बेसिक टर्म्स दैट दिस एक्चुअली हैपन्ड, एंड दे एंडेड अप लूजिंग ऑलमोस्ट 15 टू 20 लैक्स बिकॉज द एग्जैक्ट टर्म्स ऑफ वॉट इज बींग सप्लाइड, ऑन वॉट टाइम लाइन, ऑन वॉट डिलीवरी, वॉट हैपन्स इफ देर इज अ फेलियर इन डिलीवरी, ऑल दीज परमिटेशन combinations, nothing has been included in the contract at all. And for a startup to lose 15 to 20 lakhs is a
It's a
huge amount.
huge, it's a
Yeah,
huge amount,
because that
absolutely.
is when that is when when you have funding, you have funding to develop the product, right? You don't have
Absolutely,
funding.
absolutely to incur losses.
Yeah, and then they had to find a new, they had to find a new manufacturer for the product, and again they had to incur a cost. So, and of course, the idea is that nobody wants to go into legal battles. So there is a time involved, there's a cost involved, and that is something we cannot help. So if we, startups become more conscious, and I think forums like you, by tying up with relevant lawyers, and even we as lawyers know that obviously we will not be charging the startups as much as we charge the other clients. And that's okay, because this is a it's a journey. And as you said, some startups go on to become unicorns. They really grow. They get funding, and then they I mean, it's a pleasure and it's an honor to be working with startups from day one, even though the remuneration may not be the same, because you learn so much. So I learn things on a daily basis. So as you said about the brand protection, there's a very funny exchange just on LinkedIn today. So Perizad Zorabian has her own brand of chicken and called Zorabian Chicken, and Licious Meat is of course another huge brand which delivers chicken. So she shared a screenshot on Google where Licious Chicken, the moment a search is done, it shows a link to Zorabian Chicken, and she says, we don't have any tie-up with them and they are passing off on our trade. trademark, and they reverted by saying that this is not our problem, this is a Google AdWords problem, this is not something that we have done. So these are some very basic, because everything is so tech oriented, everything is online, and you end up in all sorts of issues and you may not even know. And thankfully she has applied for her she has her trademark registered, so even if there is an issue, she has a legal standing to actually haul them or ask them for to show cause as to why this happened. So this IPR, as you said, it is very critical, because your brand for most, Ola, Uber, the brand has caught on so much that the brand is synonymous with their reputation now. So registration of the trademark, how to register it, most of the times people don't know what to register, and even we advise on that as well, because there's this client who's now of she's more of a friend of mine, but she wanted to register every common name under the sun, and it was not possible. So we actually sat and made her company name together, because, and again, it was such a fruitful, and finally it did get registration. So there are a host of issues with startups face, and of course I think contract and compliance management are the two most important issues initially, because litigation is something that unless you've been around for a long time, there won't be that many disputes. But contract is something which is there from day one, because whether you're dealing with vendors, whether you're onboarding employees, whether you are no matter whichever aspect of your business, it will be on the basis of there will be a contract, and a contract is definitely not just a piece of paper. It has a lot of value. In another startup, employees were leaving during their probation, so they were leaving in 2 days, 3 days, and they had no recourse because the appointment letter didn't say anything. So we had to redraft the appointment letter and make sure that it was well aligned. We had to make sure that it was properly. It contemplated all the scenarios that that they could face with employees, all the challenges, all the issues. So getting feedback from the startups, and basis that we customize the legal advice, we work on it, and I think that is we are partners in business with the startups. I think I'll let Ketan share some thoughts, and then probably we can take it forward from there.
Sure, please. We are actually sitting to listen more about IPR. Thank you so much, Mini.
Sure.
Thank you, Mini. And so I'll just take a cue from where you left, and probably try to address some of the portions which of course come to us as daily experiences, learning, and intersections with the intellectual property regime. I'm sorry again, my video is not working, although I'm trying, but the switch is off, so please bear with me. And what I'll try to do is in the next 10-15 minutes is to try and give an overview and share some thoughts, basically, throw some ideas, share some thoughts for the absorption and digestion of the people, everyone, and also share their thoughts in terms of their experience, so that we can customize our response and probably, have some food for thought for us as well as takeaway. The idea, I think, for this session was not really to tell anything about the acts or the legal framework, etc., or the registration processes or the sections or the precedents, because that is available on a click of Google, so that everyone can have access to. But of course, to just start and have the base correct and the premise correct, of course, as Mini mentioned, there are several genres and species of intellectual property law in India, which can take the form of trademark or domain names or copyright and patents and designs, geographical indications, so on and so forth. What I want to touch on as the first point is the importance of brand and IP. Especially in case of startups, and especially in case of PE, VC, and M&A regime. So, of course, everybody knows that Facebook has taken over WhatsApp, and the valuation of these brands runs into billions of dollars. So, when we actually talk about these brands and digital companies, they don't have an asset base which is in the form of fixed asset. They don't have an employee base which is in the form of increased manpower. What they have is basically, the brand value. Now, how is that brand valued? Is there goodwill associated with it? Or is it basically the funding that they raised? Is it the projection? Is it the cash flows or what? It is actually, a large part of it is also attributed and alludable to the brand value that they have generated. So we know that, if WhatsApp is valued at 20 odd billion, then in that case, it translates into a huge amount because of the brand value that it's generated. That is the value of IPR that we're talking about. If you're talking about, so as Mini said, you know, that there are individual incentives for people, you know, to start a startup or entrepreneurial streak or family business, etc. For professionals like us also, again, you know, there are a lot of interlinkages with the IPR, because if we draft an agreement, if we put our head together over certain laws, it becomes an IPR or a copyright by virtue of us being having drafted that. And frankly speaking, you know, our individual incentive is to work with startups, MSMEs, smaller companies, is also to learn. Because when the learning curve is not stagnated, we enjoy the work process as well. We unfortunately belong to a culture in India, you know, wherein copy paste has become the norm. In Western world, you know, they have a lot of importance which is attached to non-plagiarism or original work, etc., which is why we are facing the spate of cases now in litigation, whether it's trademark litigation or specifically patent litigation. As Indians, I think, you know, we are very smart people. So we can do a lot of reverse engineering, and the techie world, you know, the people are sitting with a lot of metal and talent. But at the same time, it's very important for them to know what kind of protections are available to them. For example, in the Delhi High Court today, the maximum value litigation, I'm talking about not the volume, but the value litigation is patent litigation today. It is only belonging to three or four companies. I will name them because they are all in public domain: Ericsson, Siemens, and two pharma companies. They carry actually the most value of litigation, and one of or two hearings, you know, runs into crores and crores of rupees. The lawyers charge, obviously it's an expensive affair, you know, if you're doing an arbitration as well. But why is it even having in the first place? It is because, you know, people are not, and it applies across the board. It's not just mature companies. It also applies equally to the startups. It applies equal to the mid-sized companies, MSMEs, smaller companies, unlisted companies, private companies, all the companies alike. And that is the importance. If we don't realize, so there is a company called BharatPay. All of us know it's a platform which is a fintech platform and allows us to pay from B2C and B2B platforms as well. There was a litigation from PhonePe, we all know. There is also a company called BharatPe, and there is a company called BharatPay. That also riddled into litigation because of the phonetic similarity. There's so many factors when you actually ascribe and give a name to your business or the brand. There's so many factors to be kept in mind, and it's always advisable to actually have some advice so that you can grow goodwill along with it and not be faced with the litigation in the initial stages itself. Like, for example, I come from a very unorganized family of businesses in a part of Western UP, wherein, you know, leather shoes are manufactured, and it's known to duplicate brands like Woodland. So they will change W into G and call it Woodland and have the same kind of thing. And suddenly, you know, you'll be faced with the dawn raid in the morning, and there will be all sorts of injunctions and infringement suits, you know, against you. So long as we are not caught, everything is fine. But so long, as soon as you scale up, you come into the radar and scrutiny,
absolutely,
it becomes
absolutely
a problem. Which is why the advice is always to actually, you know, because idea is to scale up the businesses. Idea is to give something back to the society and market. And therefore, the advice is the right time to protect your interests and also to not face any objections and oppositions from the third parties becomes very important. Coming to the music industry, for example, again, media. Telecom, media, and technology, we lawyers often call it TMT practice. Now, T-Series has the largest legal team, even bigger than any law firm. They have almost 100 lawyers on their panel. Why? Because, you know, because of the huge array of media rights, moral rights, publication rights, broadcasting rights. And if you go to YouTube, you'll see that, you know, if you're watching a show and if they are playing a song which is probably copyrighted by them, that will be muted. It will not play. Because the either YouTube does not have the right to broadcast it, or they do not have the publicity right to actually, you know, play it at that time. That is the importance, because if you do it, you have lawyers of T-Series, you know, right,
absolutely
around the corner.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Correct. Ready to file a suit again.
But their T-Series were the people who started all these copying, you know, and then they had a lot of... Chale, theek hai, we'll go with that,
yes,
right?
Which is why they know the tricks of the
trade. Absolutely, absolutely.
Correct. And In all the M&A deals, without fail, you know, without exception, we always place a premium on the brand. So assuming there is a brand which is being, so there is a company which is being acquired, in that case, we will talk about the brand value also which it has generated. In more deals than not, the brand value is also given a separate monetary compensation. So assuming, you know, there is a merchant or a small MSME which starts a business of, say, pharma trading or cosmetic trading, for that example, because pharma is, again, you know, a regulated field by the NPP and DCA. So let's talk about, say, cosmetics. And that particular cosmetic brand assumes a certain goodwill, assumes a certain familiarity and acquaintance among the youth, etc., or a certain fraternity. So if the shares of that particular company are being sold, they will also charge a premium for the brand value that they have generated. That is always an incentive for the promoters to therefore, you know, scale up their brand, therefore have the visibility and propaganda in that name, and also get it trademarked and protected in their name. So I've always seen that, you know, if the shares are valued at a certain figure or valuation of enterprise, then they always get a premium if they have a brand value also registered in their name. Recently, Thracio style acquisitions, I don't know how many people are aware, but Thracio style means owning the brands, have been started by companies like Amazon and Google, etc.
Mm-hmm.
If you go on Google or Amazon marketplace and you see certain brands becoming popular in, say, childcare, or life sciences or healthcare kind of sector, in that case, the brands will be acquired by Amazon and not the shares. Mind you, the fixed assets or the intangible assets, the intangible assets are valued more than the fixed assets also. And they actually place a lot of premium, more than the building, land, machinery, equipment, etc., on the brand that they have generated, because it's catering, everything is happening online in the cloud.
Mm.
The kind of valuation and the premium which is placed on this is very, very important. The last point that I wanted to mention was in respect of what Mini already touched on. So many a times, you know, a lot of smaller ventures are faced with the problem that they come up with an idea. They hire the KMPs, which are key managerial personnel. And then sometimes what happens is because of, say, not so professional practices, etc., the idea gets stolen or, you know, taken away, and a parallel venture is started, or, you know, sometimes, you know, competition, you know, the idea is sold off to, etc., etc., and therefore does not take off. Therefore, it's very important right from the inception to have the right agreements in place. So although we all know that, you know, the confidentiality or non-disclosure is sometimes, you know, not enforceable the way it is enforced in the West world, because it's very difficult to prove that there has been a violation or a breach. So if I tell you something and you tell someone, for me to say that, you know, it came to your knowledge because it was leaked, it is very difficult for me to demonstrate and establish that fact. So which is why a lot of importance is placed on IPR, because that, if I have trademarked in my name, assuming, you know, I've trademarked a particular name or a brand or a symbol or a mascot or any kind of logo, that gets known or used by any other person, it will be much easier for me to prove that, yes, look, it is already registered in my name, and therefore you are called to cease and desist. And if you continue to do that, it will be an infringement and you're liable to pay me back in the form of damages, etc. Therein lies the value of protecting your IP. Firstly, of course, generating the IP. Secondly, protecting the IP. And number three, maintaining a good compliance and audit program in order to upgrade the IP so that it actually, you know, matches the statutory and compliance framework. And there, I think, you know, we'll try our best to come in handy for all the entrepreneurs out there to see how best we can protect their interests and ring fence them from any adverse interests.
So Ketan, at what stage, suppose for if we are talking about a startup who has just started up, maybe in a production or industry, if we take up as an example, so at what stage should they go in for an IPR?
Totally depends. So if basically it depends on two things, nature and scope of the operations. I mean, feel free to supplement my understanding. I'll just have one thought here. It is totally subject and dependent on the nature and work scope of two things, either the product they are building or the suite of services that the enterprise is engaged in. If it's the product, then of course, you know, they can go for a trademark. By what name is it called? By what name is it advertised, etc., as soon as they have the idea in place and a workable model.
Mm-hmm.
And in respect of services also, if they have come up with a plan that, you know, this is how I'm trying to, you know, for say software companies, this is the algorithm or this is the workflow, or this is the diagram of my thought process in which the product is delivered and I'm providing the services in that regard. So that also is process patented in India as per the Patent Act. Vinny, would you like to add? At what stage they can probably go for this particular?
Yeah, I would appreciate if you could elaborate on this a little bit.
So, trademark is something, of course, which as early as possible, because the brand, it completely depends on what the product is. So I think there's certain services, there are certain, like for lawyers, you know, a lot of people, they will not really care about the name of my law firm, because I am synonymous, you know, because at the end of the day, you know, or even in a bigger law firm, you know the particular partner that you're working with, right? The name of the law firm. So it may not be that important. You identify with people, but in a product or a service, you identify with the name of the brand. So whether housing.com, you know that for a property search, or you say PropTiger. So the moment you hear of these names, or booking.com, you identify with that brand from day one. So it is the brand that has the recognition with the consumers. So I think a lot of brands, they change their names over a period of time. Again, trademark registration is not a very fast process. It is advertised in a trademarks journal. The registrar is given an option to either, accept it or reject it. And even he may have certain queries. And after that, it is published so that if there's any other brand which is similar, they can object to it. So the process takes anywhere between 1 or 2 years. Now, what happens is that you have built a brand over, you have already started supposed production of your product with that trademark. And after 2 years, you find that the trademark has been rejected. So then you can obviously cannot continue using the trademark because, it has already failed. So that is why sometimes it is important that it is possible that a trademark can get rejected even after a couple of years. The oppositions, I remember there was a time when I was working with ITC, and ITC and HUL kept having a battle with each other. Later they settled it, but ITC had a brand called Sunfeast and HUL had a brand called Feast. And they used to object to any variant of each other. So there were at any time there were some 30 matters which were Feast versus Sunfeast, Feast versus Sunfeast, some for biscuit, orange flavored biscuit, lychee flavored biscuit. They were basically spending a huge amount on legal costs, but then they are big corporations which can afford to take that kind of a hit. But for a smaller startup, it may not be possible. So that is why having at least that kind of level of diligence and check should be done before applying for a trademark, to ensure that at least the chances are, at least more than 70 to 80% where you will get the trademark protected, because otherwise you would have spent a huge amount in branding and in marketing. And at the end of it, it is still possible that it gets rejected. And the timeline is anywhere between 2 years. Another thing is, of course, if you have creating so much of branding and advertising, and then you say that you can show that you have been using it, prior usage is a good ground. So even if somebody else has a trademark which is very similar to yours, and but from the last, you are using the trademark from the last 3 years or 4 years, and it's all over. It's all over social media. It's all over the newspapers. You can show a lot of evidence that you have been using it, and that the public identifies that trademark with you. In that case, even if there is somebody who's using it, who has applied for a registration later, you will get the protection, because you have a lot of evidence to show that there is prior use and that you have been using it for a long time. So that is even common names. So Xerox was the name of a company, but now we use it as a common name. So sometimes that happens. There are trademarks which are so widely known, they are also identified as well-known trademarks under the Madrid Convention, because they are so well-known and they have become synonymous with that product itself. But for a trademark to become so well-known, it takes time, of course, a lot of marketing costs, and a lot of effort. So that is.
So is there any policy change if a startup is starting, their production is, suppose it's an Indian based company, but they have their offices and their products are being produced at some other, in other countries. So is there any different policies in both cases, or the same policy is on an international level?
So the trademark, Ketan, you want to add?
I just want to add on the Indian bit, on the process. So there have been two very good changes. So basically now everything is online. So even if we have the trademark offices, which are 4 or 5 in number, but the process is very centralized and digitized rather. So when you the benefit is, when you come to a lawyer, say that this particular brand we have come up with, what we do is something called a background search.
Okay.
When you do the background search, correct. So we will be able to advise you, or any good lawyer would be able to advise you that, this is a brand which is not prone to a challenge. When we say challenge, it can be either by third parties / competitor, or it could be by the registry itself. Okay. Registry, it's called the objection, and a third party is called the opposition. So a background search is always important to actually, go ahead with some kind of protection. And secondly, as Mini also mentioned, by very virtue of using it, for example, copyright, if you have not really branded it, but you have written something, which is a piece of art, or which is a story, or which is a poem, etc. You also have a common law right you don't necessarily need to register it. You already have a tort law or a common law right by virtue of having written it and being able to prove it that, it's a work of art which has been produced by you.
Mm-hmm.
Mini, I think you can touch on the extraterritorial aspects, because that's a good question. If the product is being used in other states or jurisdictions as well, how can we protect it?
Sure. So there are trademark applications which can be done for, there are various treaties under which the application can be made, and we can get protection under different jurisdictions as well. So, if a product is being, but if it is being manufactured in India, it completely depends on which jurisdiction you sense that there could be a challenge, or there could be a competitive, a competing business. Because if it is being manufactured and marketed in India, then you would end up having the competitors in India as well. But if your product is being sold, it all depends on how many territories do you have your establishment in, how many territories are you operating in. And of course, if there are, because there are certain companies like, say, Bajaj Electricals, it's a huge company. Mm-hmm. So they deliver the product on a worldwide level. So they actually, they are looking to trademark their name across some 60 to 70 countries that they have identified, because they routinely supply the products in those countries. Mm-hmm. So it completely, but it's a cost. It is a big cost. And I think for a startup, it may not be a cost which, because the amounts could go up to 1.5 to 2 crores just to do the trademark applications in so many countries. So I don't think that is a cost. But of course, the idea is to identify territory wise, and not, you don't need to apply in every jurisdiction to begin with, and only start with the jurisdictions where you are actually, where you will be supplying most of the product, and where you will be focusing. Right, Ketan? You want
That's
to add
correct.
Something?
So
any controversy, if it happens, it'll be settled in that particular jurisdiction only.
Correct. So what we have also, these days, because of the Madrid Convention that Mini said. So if there is a product which is being used, say, on e-commerce, for example.
Mm-hmm.
Now, e-commerce, you cannot identify the territories. So if there is eBay in US also, eBay is world over.
Mm-hmm.
In that case, what you also advise, if they are not identifiable jurisdictions, to go for a Madrid protocol kind of filing. So this is international application. So whichever country is signatory or ratifier to the Madrid protocol, which is currently over 100 countries, and the fee is around, say, 1.5 lakhs, which is slightly higher. But if you go for just Indian registration, but it's comparatively much lower if you go for separate registration, you can do that as well. In that case, I would also mention that, assuming we start with India. So if the target is only India, in that case, I think the MSMEs are given the benefit of 50% of the registration fee. So if a normal fee is, say, 9,000 per mark per class, because there are various classes, around 45 classes of trademarks. So there is exemption, at least in case of trademark filing and registration, up to 50%. So if a normal company, which is not an MSME, is charged, or not a startup, not MSME, but only a startup, is charged 9,000 per mark per class, then there is an exemption which provides them a discount of 50% and they can go ahead with the registration accordingly in that given class.
Okay. All right. So if a very small micro unit is applying for it, will there be any special concession depending upon the categories?
MSME, it's already, I think, 4,500, which is half the price for the bigger for companies. So for MSMEs and for startups it, and individual proprietors, it is half the price. And if you have a startup recognition, then 50% rebate, as Ketan said, that is applicable.
Okay. All right. So if they are having this registration, is there any benefit for these startups if they are working with government organizations?
So the fees, the rebate is the biggest benefit, and the government itself has various impaneled service providers, and they get 50% even for patent, for trademark, for all the IPR registrations. They are given rebate, and of course there are various tax concessions and other tax benefits which are given. But of course for the various schemes also there are one has to be registered to avail various schemes under the government, but tax and IPR are the two biggest benefits of being registered as a startup. And the process is very simple. It's an online process, and you just have to show that
any lump sum or big amount of documentation for the process, or it's
no,
a very simple,
no,
easy go. Anybody
it's
can
a very 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 simple.
Okay.
Process.
Okay. All right. Okay.
No, it's very friendly. Yes, I agree. It's very friendly to the startups. And in addition to the other benefits that they already have, you know, in credit link subsidies, Skill Up India, Atmanirbhar, etc. In terms of IPR, one, they clearly enjoy a rebate in the registration fee. And secondly, in terms of documentation also, it is very much expedited. So the list of documents is pretty simple, straightforward. The very important thing is, yes, they're not relying on an existing kind of a name. And so if a good background search has been done, I think that really helps in expediting the process of trademark. So for example, if you're making a logo which is similar to an existing logo, etc., of course they can be advised, you know, to change the logo and fit it to the kind of product or services suite at hand.
It's something like if you're opening a new email account and you use your name or whatever, and if it's replicate with somebody's already existing, the Gmail or any provider, they prompt you that name is already being in use, so you have to choose a different name, something like that.
Exactly.
No, so there is no
So just one thought, and before Manish says, so one is basically, as you mentioned, you know, domain names. There's a lot of clicking and shopping, you know, which happens there. So when somebody knows that, you know, look, now the FDI approval of this particular company has been given, and assuming you know, Alphabet is coming into India, so they will start, you know, registering all the domain names in the GoDaddy and other service or other, you know, domain name providers. Then you will not get the name, and then you know you'll have to shop for the name from these people who own it. But in this case, the background search works slightly differently. So phonetically and visibility wise, so it has to be different. So assuming, you know, it leads to, the test is deceptive similarity in case of trademark. So basically in, this aspect, what we do is in the background search, we look for similar classes. So if basically you are manufacturing a pen and the same name is manufactured or rather registered in say case of laptops, these are totally different markets, you know, may not really lead to any kind of confusion among the public. So that test of reasonableness, proportionality and deceptive similarity is applied. And then, you know, of course, we can come up with some ideas. But the idea is to actually, you know, keep it distinct and clear and related to your business as much as possible. Sorry, Mini, I interrupted.
No, absolutely.
So in case if the registration process fails, and after 2 years you come to know that the entire process has failed, so what about the fees? You reapply it, you get the same fees gets adjusted, or you repay?
Yeah, there's no scope for readjusting. So basically, once you apply, that fee is kind of non-refundable.
Okay.
So it would be 9,000 for a company, it would be 4,500. And as Ketan said, it is per mark per class. So what happens is that, you know, sometimes sometimes when there are overlapping classes. So mm-hmm. you would, so your brand name, suppose you are making shoes. So you would want your brand name to be protected in the category for shoes, but you will also be printing it on, say, certain literature. You will also be distributing pamphlets. So you also want it in the category of paper and printing. So mm-hmm. you generally apply in 2-3 classes. So the fees actually gets multiplied by that much. Mm-hmm. That adds on, but yes, unfortunately there's no scope for a refund. It is if the name fails, then one has to do the entire process all over again.
Okay, the entire work that was put in the first attempt has to be again, the entire effort has to be redone.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
So, is why that background search and the prior search is very important to make sure that as far as possible it is. As lawyers, we do a very thorough search of any other mm-hmm. mark which is similar or which could, and we have a fair idea on what grounds they are rejected. Mm-hmm. So there are, under the Act, there are 3-4 grounds on which it is rejected, like being similar, deceptively similar, phonetically similar. So identical, of course, you cannot have identical. To someone else
what do you mean by deceptively similar? Could you just expand this?
So deceptively similar is like it is not exactly similar, but you're kind of giving an idea that it is like, say, rediff and radif, that mm-hmm. would be deceptively similar. So passing off is a very big concept in trademark. It is it comes from UK, which says that you're basically trying to piggyback on the brand of someone else. So that is why Rediff nobody knows, but because rediff. It is so similar to rediff, so some people might come and they will come to your brand just thinking that it's probably rediff. So that is the idea. So deceptively similar, identical, of course, and sometimes you can there are ways to work around it. Like if the mark which is similar to yours is in another category completely, and you can show that, again, it depends on how well known that mark is. So some marks are so well known that now they have crossed the category. So you cannot, for instance, you can't apply for an Ola now in any category. You say I'm making shoes with the name Ola, that also they will not allow you, because they'll be like, Ola is so big. So the idea is that the consumer should not get fooled. The consumer should not think that, okay, Ola is so big, they probably ventured out into shoes also. Mm. So that is the understanding, that it should not any confusion to the public. Ketan, you want to add to that?
I think that's a great information.
Yeah. I think, really, they are such interesting case laws. I think they're worth a read, especially the courts have come across matters like, Lakme versus Lakme, Picnic with a K versus Picnic with a C, Cadilla with a double L. So the jurisprudence is so fantastic, in this. And then, of course, there's a case of Officer's Choice versus Body. So a lot of cases have happened, and yes, the bottom line remains the same, that it should not lead to a reasonably informed person of the public to be confused between the brands or the defendant's brand name. So as Mini mentioned, it should not lead to confusion that the same company has ventured out in another line of business, mm-hmm. or it should not get confused that these two are the same, which basically may be different actually by different companies.
Okay. Even if they are using the name for a different category, yet it won't be allowed.
Yeah.
Unless, if it's very, very popular, then if it's not, then if there's a drug which is sold by the name of XYZ and there's mm-hmm. a shoe name. So typically not, unless XYZ has become such a common generic name, that's mainly for confusion.
Absolutely. Just like Crocine is there. So it's so people know Crocine. So that's wonderful. There was something. Agreement with customers and vendor. So
I think we'll need another session to do the agreements and the.
So anything, I think there's a question by Mr. Deepak Ray. Any possibility under law to brand reserved for 2 to 3 years when the business established trademark will be registered.
Sorry, Deepak, you want to elaborate on that?
Reserving a brand, I think, you know,
any possibility under law to brand. Deepak, can you please?
Here actually what it means basically, for example, any kind of startup, I'm actually practicing Chartered Accountant Chennai, and I have come across, they have very good plan for next 5 years, but they have different vertical. And for the time being, for first 1 or 2 years, they are little actually not sure about the business and all those things. In that case, whether any particular brand, for example, say ABC, so that can be under government, can be actually reserved that this brand will be for my business or something. And some cushion time, Deepak, 1 year or 2 years.
Yeah, once you get a registration, the registration is actually valid for 10 years.
Here actually what my question basically, without registration, the kind of actually that we will intimate to government that yes, this is actually organization.
Your application is good enough. So Deepak, I have seen your question now on the chat. So basically you're saying that during the life cycle of the registration itself, can you block it exclusively for yourself?
Exactly.
Correct. So the answer is basically, you know, the exclusivity or the monopoly, you know, you will get only after the trademark gets registered. So the process is expedited. Of course, you know, it depends on how the process is run, etc. But during that time, you can continue to use that mark, of course. And if tomorrow there's a litigation, and if you can demonstrate that, you know, you started the prior use ahead of others, then rest assured your application itself works as a proof that yes, it has been blocked in your favor from that very day. So if you apply it today and you get the registration next year, if there is any kind of, you know, misuse or not misuse, but plagiarism or violation or breach during this particular year, and if your application has been admitted first or made first, then basically the other person will be asked to stop immediately.
Okay. Very, very nice reply. I understood completely.
Thank you, Deepak. Thank you for your question. There's a question by Chitiz. What is the duration of trademark? So
10 years, yeah.
10 years,
and then you can keep reapplying for renewal.
So after 10 years, the fees a little less for the person, or it will be on the basis of the current price.
I think the renewal fee is the same.
It's the same. So it's
same.
Exactly the same. So it is assumed by the registry that, you know, they would have generated enough gains and benefits by using the brand monopoly.
Mm-hmm.
So So it's on a lesser side. So typically, I'll tell you, the fee is registration 9,000 or 4,500, as the case may be. And then, you know, there are some charges by the patent attorney or the trademark attorney, which are less than that. So it's assumed by the registry that, you know, these gains would be reaped during the life cycle of the trademark, and therefore you can pay afresh.
All right. So how soon, like suppose my tenure is going to get completed, say tomorrow. So how soon should I reapply it?
I think it is 6 months prior to the expiry that you need to reapply. There's a few months.
So suppose the person forgets to reapply, and immediately after, you know, that somebody else apply it in the same name. So what happens in that case?
So I think there's a grace period given, but even if a person applies immediately, that person will again take 2 years to get the protection, right? So in that, and this person would have had a prior use by virtue of the prior registration. So nobody can actually just reap the benefit from a small window as such.
Okay.
Because you can then show that it's all about showing usage. And another thing is that trademark has to be, of course, as I said, registration is important, but using it is also very important, because otherwise a competitor can file an application that you're not using it, and they can even ask the registrar to remove your mark.
If it's not active, then it can be removed.
Yes, because you cannot sit on a mark without using it. So because 10 years is a long period. So even if you're not using it at all, then a competitor can use that to their advantage.
All right, that's a great piece of information. So there's a question from Mr. Moto. Please, you can go ahead and ask your question. Please unmute yourself.
Hi. So my name is Nikki Thakrao.
Okay.
And I am a founder of a technology product-based startup. So my question was that if there is a technology which was patented, like the utility patent has been done in 1990s and before 2000, so that 20-year period has expired. But there have been some when these people have they have applied for additional patents for the layer of patents on top of the basic patent. And other than that, so my question was that if I don't have a utility patent of a certain technology or something, but I possibly can get a design patent of that particular machine with changes and modification of my own creation. Can this be protected in India per se? I don't want to go outside India as of now or probably for next 5 years. So can that be protected in India? I hope you understand my question.
So is your invention capable? Yeah, is your invention capable of industrial application?
Yes. So currently our product is under torture testing and user validation phase. So we are testing it with various industries and various people and subjecting it to various types of tests for its robustness and user application. And we are planning to launch by next year. And before that, we want to go ahead with the patents and everything. So I've done prior art research, I've done it on my own. So I have came across that there are multiple utility patents across the globe. Like there are a few companies in Italy and some in Germany who have patented this project back in 1990s and before 2000. Mm-hmm. So there are other patents on top of that, but the base technology patent has been expired for sure. So now can I get a design patent or what should be my strategy for IPR in this kind of a situation?
I think if it is capable of industrial application, if you have done those tests, then we can then you can apply for the design.
Okay, so I shouldn't even worry about utility patent or anything. I should just focus on design patents, right?
Yeah, because since there was a prior patent, so I think if you can show that there is an industrial application, then the design then you can get the design protection.
Okay. And design patents are valid for how much period of time?
No, patent is basically 20 years only. So utility patent actually correct. So there's two points here. One, patent is very territorial. So Nikki, basically, even if you see utility patents on that particular technology or the novelty or that particular product slash process elsewhere, it doesn't really affect you if it's not patented already in India. It's a territorial concept.
Okay.
Number two, if you think that you can pass the muster and robustness of a product or a process patent in India, by all means, as Minnie mentioned, there are three tests. If you can pass these three tests and any lawyer, any patent lawyer, trust me, it's a very specialized field. So any patent lawyer can do a stress test for you. Stress test meaning, whether it will pass the muster or the regulations or not. And tell you, whether it's patentable or not. It is definitely worth going for a patent if you strongly believe in it, if you have the requisite supporting documents and studies and empirics. And as you mentioned, some feasibility studies already underway. So why not get some advice of a patent lawyer and we can of course help you out and go for it. Even if there are utility patents in Italy, etc., one, they do not affect you. And secondly, if they've expired, then in any case, they don't affect
you. Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you. There's a question from Shagun. Product design is progressive. So how do you advise going for a design patent in such a case?
Yeah. Hi, Mini. Preeti and Ketan. So we are a product design startup, basically working for healthcare and other physical and mental need patients and users. So in our case, we focus more on the design. So like our designs are progressive every 6 months, like any other design company. So we could patent at the alpha prototype stage at first, because in that case, we have to give it out for feedback and other HMI and stuff. So, but then later on, let's say after 6 months or let's say after 3 months, there are design changes. So like, is it obvious that I have to apply for like another patent so that even for a minor
patent, see, your invention will remain the same, right? Your invention continues to remain the same. You're just changing the design. So you will not have to change the patent at each time, because patent is only granted for the invention. So your underlying invention will always remain the same.
Okay.
But the design that you are applying to industry, that design is constantly changing.
Yeah.
So the patent will not change.
Okay. And one small question. So, talking about trademark and registration, so I have a bigger studio, an umbrella under which there are series of products. So like we are a family of products. So like, let's say one of my products is for healthcare for adults and one is for toys and other aspects. So every time I launch something, I have to individually trademark each and every vertical.
Is your brand name different or is your brand name the same?
So like my studio is called Khel Studio. So it's based on an ideology. But then the product, let's say for healthcare, is called ABC something. So I need to make my trademarks and registration for ABC as well, right?
Yeah, Shagun, if you're trying to capture your consumer, your target consumer, if you want to capture their interest for each product separately, and you want that for the healthcare, they should identify with a particular name. You want that for the, for the adult, whatever. I mean, depending on each segment, if you want to capture their interest separately, then it is better to, and if you have separate names, you know, as you said, XYZ, ABC, then it is always advisable to go with separate trademark applications. Because you want, it's more about consumer retention. So you want the consumer to remember that name, right? You want them to identify, because in each segment, you will have competitors. So you want the consumer to identify you as the relevant person for that particular segment, right? So then you should apply, separately.
Okay. Thank you for your time. Yeah.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Shagun, I hope your questions.
Yeah, answer.
And I would love to know your products. What are you into, Shagun? So we'll connect later on, because healthcare and all, I would really love, we will connect later on.
Sure.
There's a question put up by Reshma. So Reshma, if you could kindly unmute and directly you can ask.
Yeah, sure. Thank you, Preeti. So my question is, we are into a social cause segment, but we are again a private limited company. We want to secure the brand name and logo, but our product is an app based product. So this app would be copyrighted or trademarked? So I'm not very clear on the fundamental concept.
The app would be copyrighted. And if you have a brand name, that would be trademarked. So there are two separate things. So there must be a certain name with which you are going ahead, right? So if you want to protect the brand, you can do a trademark of the brand. But the app per se, the coding of the app, the code that you have written, all of that is subject to copyright law.
Okay, very well. So two different processes, right?
Yes.
Oh, we would recommend don't go for the copyright registration. It's inherently anywhere with you. Go for branding or any kind of publicity, marketing and selling that you're doing using that brand. Definitely get that trademark. Copyright for the digital or the binary or the object code, source code, etc. is not required, because inherently it's best with you. Unless you think that, you know, there is a seeming application which is now coming up, etc., etc. So if you think that, you know, there is, because it's a social cause, hence I mentioned this.
Okay, understood. Very well. Thank you so much, team.
I know. Thank you, Reshma. There's a question put up by Advocate Nilmani Gandhi. Nilmani ji, if you're there, kindly go ahead and ask your question.
Yeah, thank you, Preeti, for giving me this opportunity. Please. My question, Mini, to you is, or Ketan, anybody. because we in Maharashtra, no, we are there are few clients who are coming from a remote area, and they have applied for their patent and copyright. So when applied for a patent, there was an objection about their shoe products and leather product. But we had submitted the objections and the answer to the objection, but not yet received any answer from the authority. Can we consider it as it is granted or objection is removed?
No, no, definitely not. So unfortunately, there is a, we cannot do that. We can definitely follow up with the particular office, and we can, you know, we can take it up with them. But unless and until they approve of it, unless and until the registration is granted, it cannot be assumed that it has been removed.
Okay, because it's prior to 1 year we have submitted.
That's the government processes. Sometimes they are that long. So, but unfortunately, we cannot assume. Ketan, do you want to add something to that?
They can still continue with the production and marketing procedures.
Yeah, but unless the registration is granted, that exclusive right will not be there.
All right. Okay,
so they cannot use the logo, right?
They can use the logo.
They can. Okay. Correct. Right. So basically, you know, what you can do is, of course, you can continue using, because objection is by the registry itself. So they would have given the objection to which you have responded if they would have given a requisition to which you have provided the information. In that case, ideally, they should respond immediately. If not, of course, follow-ups are very handy. But if they are not, and it's been a year, they are not responding, etc., you can definitely continue. My only question is it not published in the trademark journal also? Is it still status quo ante which is prevailing, or any movement whatsoever? Because sometimes what they do is they don't respond, but they publish it in the journal, in which case it's deemed to be done. But if it's not published, then of course, you know, we'll have to follow up or some kind of technical snag.
It is not, unfortunately, it is not published.
Right.
Okay.
So, some judicial remedy, of course, you know, you can apply for RTM. So we've done a similar thing, but in that case, it was an MNC client. So may not be very applicable for, a local client, but of course, you know, a severe follow-up can be done and some kind of direction be issued to the registry, you know, in that regard to respond to that. Typically, RTI is done. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Nilmani. Thank you so much. There's a similar question by Mr. Milan. How soon the objection hearing happens?
I think it happens within 5 to 6 months. But again, this completely depends on the case.
Yeah, actually, that's what the advocate Nilmani just now asked. We have also, there was objection, and we have also replied to that objection for, I think, in the month of January now. It's more than 9 months now, and we have not heard anything from them yet. So I was just wondering how much time does it take?
I think right now it's taking is exceptionally long also because of the pandemic, because there's another client of mine who's facing this issue, and they've also, it's been around 8-9 months. So so we are following up with the registry, and I think that is, someone has to either visit them or probably call them and check what is the status, because I think in the pandemic this has happened with a lot of people.
I have one question to Mr. Ketan Makija also. Initially, in the initial part of your speech, you mentioned about the brand value and this. So I just wonder, how do we, calculate, or we can say, judge brand value? See, what we are providing is also providing the services, technology-based solution provider, and on the financial side also, we are providing tax preparation and this kind of services. So I have, for tax services and all, I have created a brand name. That under that brand name, I have registered even a domain name, and I'm promoting with that brand name the financial services. So how do you calculate the brand value? How do you judge it?
Sure. So Milan, interesting question. So basically, you know, brand equity is what brand value is. And there are multiple ways, you know, just like any other business, there are multiple ways to approach the valuation of a brand. It can be cost-based, it can be income-based, it can be market-based, it can be book value-based. But typically what they do is, these days, they do a projection as to what will be the value, or you forecast the value of the business. You try to synonymize the value of your business by virtue of the marks or the product that you're using, and then come up with a forecast or a projection, as we call it, and then do a discounted cash flow methodology. Go to a CA or a merchant banker who does the valuation for you, so that there is a scientific way of valuing it. But of course, the valuation is yours. You'll have to provide for some parameters to say that, you know, this is the cost you've invested in building that brand. You'll have to provide some kind of market-based research that these are the brand value of equivalent customers or other competitors who are there in the market using a similar or nearly equivalent product. And you, of course, have to provide for some parameters which generate in revenue and income. So those financial parameters will be incorporated in your financial model, which, if deemed robust, will give you the right valuation of your brand basis the forecasting. So there are a lot of value. There are a lot of methods to answer your question in line. But yes, what is the value in this particular regard? I think a good chartered accountant and a lawyer combination will be best able to tell you that. It is typically on the forecasting of value of your business in the years to come. And using that terminal year, then you discount it cash flow and arrive at the net present value of your brand.
Okay, thank you very much. Nice explanation.
Thank you, Milan. Thank you for your question. There's a question put up by Mr. Abhijit Agarwal. How copyright to a logo can help additionally after the trademark is done?
So copyright is basically nobody can copy that exact, can make something which is exactly similar to that. And, as Ketan has also mentioned a couple of times, that copy, you don't need to separately, there's an implied copyright in all the works of art that we make, or all the content we generate, anything in writing. So there would be an implied copyright anyways, but of course, trademark is the better protection, because trademark you can get your you can get the logo protected, you can get the name protected, you can get them protected in various combinations. So, people opt for black and white so that protection, so that they can challenge anybody using that logo, even in other color combinations. So there are a lot of considerations. I mean, there are a lot of issues and considerations, but trademark is the best way to protect. And yes, if you, for a logo specifically, you can go for the particular color combination that you are using, as well as a black and white logo protection, so that it just increases the ambit of the protection that is offered to you.
Absolutely. There's a similar question. Can there be blanket protection for content generated by us?
There is a blanket protection, but yeah, I think it is important that protect against any kind of malware. And if you're talking about content in the form of your website, then there's simple disclaimers that the content is owned by, and put your company name, put the relevant year in which the content was generated, so that it's just about creating proof of ownership in simple terms. But then, of course, any kind of content that we create, we have ownership over it.
Any duration for trademark?
10 years. And it can be renewed any number of times.
All right. Deepak's Milind. Anybody else's question, kindly raise your hand or unmute yourself, and directly one can ask the questions. Yeah, Milan, please go ahead and ask the question.
Yeah, I have one more question on copyright. Say, for example, we are a technology company and developing software, and we have copyrighted it. Now, there are cases that where we have employee or we subcontract this development to somebody. After that completion of this, say employee leaves our organization, or the contract is over from the subcontractor, it has been handed over. But there are chances that the employee or the subcontractor may tweak that software and, sell it to somebody else after tweaking it. I mean, you understand tweaking. I mean, software, there may be minor changes, and then they sell it or they do it for someone else. So how can we, protect ourselves there? How can we restrict them?
So you're talking about after the employee exits?
Yeah, there are chances that employee may be there, or maybe after the exit of employee. I mean, he may have copied, suppose that source code, or maybe in his brain also. See, I mean, it's all ultimately it is a brain. You know, I mean, that he remembers that what he has done. So,
Now, one of the protections, I think, for anybody who's dealing, of course, copyright is something which is which you have registered, and the legal recourse is a way. But I think even within the contract with all your employees and everybody who is dealing with the tech side of things, it is important that your employee contracts specifically, you know, you take all the representations from your employees, you take all the, for whatever, and especially if there's a risk that they could be going to a competitor. So there could be a restrictive period even after they leave, where you tell them that they cannot, for 1 year or 2 years, where they cannot be dealing in a similar software, or they should not be doing any kind of a similar business. Because when, and that kind of restrictive period is deemed reasonable by most courts in India. So at least it is just to give you further legal protection. I mean, of course, under copyright law, you would have the recourse, but also to all your employees who are dealing with a sensitive software, I think you should have this kind of a clause in the contract where they cannot, where it is a specific, especially from the tech personnel, that there should not be any kind of a reverse engineering, there should not be any kind of a modification. And you can even quantify certain damages, that especially if it is done during the tenure, and if you come to know of that, you can even deduct it from their salary or from their full and final settlement. So it's because for you, I'm guessing for you, the tech is really critical, and it is very critical to your business. So these are, or even with third parties, if you're dealing, this is, it's quite important to include these things in the contract.
Yeah, okay. So the important is that contract, of course, that those clauses have been already included in the subcontractors, this thing. But I found, not exactly with our own subcontractors, but I have understood that there are certain other people who are doing this in the market, that although the clause is there, they are tweaking the software and then selling that software to the other people. So that is my concern, that even though the clause is there, the contract is signed and everything, after some time, maybe after 6 months or a year, they tweak that software, and then they sell it to some other person.
Correct. So Milind, from the practical aspect, we'll suggest a couple of things. As Mini has said, one is, of course, the contract. So if it's your employee, then it's a work for hire. If it's a contractor, again, it's a work for hire.
Yeah.
Basically, the intellectual property in the product, in the software, in the coding, in the architecture belongs to you as an organization.
Correct. Yeah.
In that case, what we typically do, one way, of course, is to fight it out in the court, which is not very friendly in India. Again, you know, we can have a 30-page contract, which again, you know, may or may not be providing you, as you rightly said, providing you the desired outcome. Typically, what the companies do wherein the critical or complex software is involved, and there is a chance of tweaking it or making it slightly modified and then deploying it and, you know, using it for another purposes commercially, then in that case, whenever you sign an undertaking by the employee or the consultant, as the case may be, at the time and at the time of leaving, at the time of joining and at the time of leaving, at the time of joining, to say that, you know, these are the things that you have developed in the past. This is something which is your own invention or own work of product, etc., etc. You develop the same thing. I know it's a complicated piece, but it really helps in practical scenarios. You develop the same kind of list, which we call a disclosure list, at the end of leaving, whether you be terminated, whether you resign, or whether something happens, etc. You again develop that list and add to that. And then you see that all these additions are belonging to the company and they cannot be used by anyone. And then you basically make it public to your competitors. You don't make the public entirely, obviously, your software, but at least the headline of that software.
Okay.
Two things happen. One, of course, you know, that person cannot use that as part of his own brainchild when he joins the competitor. And secondly, you draw up a trail, which is a defensible trail that, you know, if at all you have to raise it in a court of law or take some criminal measures also, because copyright has criminal manifestations also, you can at least create a disincentive for the competitor to use the same software because it's already there in the public. Okay. It's now being used by certain people. But yes, of course, you know, subject to the customizations and requirements of your business.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thanks.
Milind, I hope your query is being now answered.
Yeah, sure.
There's a question which has come up from Vasudev. Can I protect ideas from prospective co-founders?
So for that, the co-founder, from prospective co-founders, okay, so for that, the co-founders agreement is actually the most important, the piece of the document which governs the relationship between co-founders. But if you are looking to just pitch your idea to somebody and take it up, then of course, start with an NDA, which is the most basic requirement before you share your ideas with anyone, and which will clearly state that you are the owner of that protective of that particular idea. And because of course, if you are looking for prospective co-founders, you will have to share the details. You cannot not share the details, right? So the only way to do that is to have a very exhaustive NDA and basis that only share the ideas, and don't do it in an informal basis or over a phone call or over a coffee. Just make sure it is all in writing and it is after you sign an NDA.
So what happened, Mini and Ketan, like if suppose there's a startup and there are say 3 to 4 co-founders, and you know, after getting trademarks and things like that, eventually when they get separated, suppose, you know, after 3-4 years, 4-5 years, the business split. So in that case, what happens to the trademark and copyrights and things?
So Ketan, do you
want to go? Sure. So of course, you know, it depends on what the understanding contractually is between the founders. So currently, whatever develops, you know, typically, you know, it belongs to the organization. So assuming, you know, there is a brand, whenever you apply, you'll have to say who's the proprietor of that brand, trademark, intellectual property, copyright, whatever. If you choose to be an individual, that of course is a considered a decision. But typically, in most circumstances, it is the name of the organization, say Messrs. XYZ Private Limited, is mainly the owner. Now, when the founders separate, again, you know, the severance agreement will list out what they contractually have agreed for. Typically, again, what happens is, if assuming, you know, three friends have developed an idea, one of the friends tomorrow, you know, the other two partners do not like his whatever, you know, for personal reasons, you know, he decides to walk away. Then whatever the value he's created, assuming he says that, you know, the entire idea was developed by me, but it was registered in the name of the company and he wants to sever. Then in that case, either it's a contractual arrangement which they have to agree to, which is basically, you know, give him some monetary compensation and the intellectual property continues in the name of the organization for that particular effort. Or if they don't agree, then it has to be proved by the gentleman who's leaving that, you know, it was his brainchild, but it's very, very difficult. So which is why these critical decisions are taken at the time of registration. So as Mini said, you know, the founder's agreement, whenever they say that, you know, this is a joint effort, etc., it has to be a considered decision by all the founders that, look, you are putting in sweat and toil into this effort. And therefore, you know, if there is an exit or severance tomorrow, this would be the repercussions. So typically, it's governed by the contractual relationship and the agreements what we draw. I've done a lot of agreements these days in edtech. So education and technology, you combine it together. As a layman, we cannot think of so many ideas that can come through. But trust me, you know, there's so many ideas which have. They're not protected. They're only protected contractually. So it provides for all. So a good lawyer will always provide for all the eventualities in case this happens, that happens, etc., etc. Then
most of the startups are coming up with, you know, 2 or 3 co-founders are there and then they are starting up with their business. But then eventually, you know, as things grow and sometimes relationship and they fall apart, the business fall apart. So what happens to all the trademarks? And if somebody wants to really continue with the company with the existing product line, so then what exactly happens? Does the person who's holding the company and the product right now pay the money to the person who has exited from the organization? can the person who's exiting can ask for money for especially for the trademarks that has been created in the name of the organization?
He can definitely ask, but he'll have to agree. The parties will have to agree. So that's what I said, Preeti. You know, if they agree, excellent. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you know, typically it gets registered in the name of the proprietor. And as you know, the company's legal entity is distinct from its members or shareholders. So the company is a going concern. So regardless of who joins mm-hmm. and who comes mm-hmm. in, you know, the company will go on forever. That is the concept.
Mm-hmm.
So which is why at the time of severance, typically the founder's agreement lay out mm-hmm. all those contours that, you know, in case this happens, so and so will happen. So it's a pre-agreed situation rather than agreeing on later.
Absolutely. Deepal, you have a question?
Yes. Hi. Actually, I have an atta manufacturing company. So mm-hmm. basically, I wanted to know that the scenario is our brand name is very common, and like other companies are also using the same brand name with, you know, similar with prefix or suffix to it.
Mm-hmm.
So it is very common, but our logo is very different. We have created the logo in very different way. So no other company has that kind of design.
Mm-hmm.
So, and we have already started this trademark process for the logo, but I wanted to know, I want a suggestion that how can we go forward with the logo and the company name, because we are using the same name on our product as well.
So Deepal, are you sure you would want to continue with the same name? Because as you're saying, since others are also using the same name,
yeah.
it is very unlikely that you will get a protection for the name per se. Huh? So okay. So your name, when you apply for a name for the trademark, in all probability, it will get rejected. But if okay. your logo is different, then what you can do is, of course, you can apply for the logo and that will get registered. And you can apply for a combination of this name with the logo. So wherever the logo and the name below it, you can apply for that in conjunction also. So even if there's an objection, you can justify it by saying that the logo part is completely different. So it doesn't matter even if the name is common. Hmm. So although you will not get a word mark as such, but that logo with that name can get registered.
Okay. So we can. So I can get the combination registered.
Yes. Like
the name and the design.
Yeah, but for abundant caution, you should apply for just the logo as well, because in case there's an objection and you are not able to get the registration, then you should. So I would advise you to apply for the logo as well as the name and the logo in these two combinations.
Okay, so basically I need to apply two applications, right?
Yeah, just the logo and name and logo. So that way you should have a decent protection.
Okay. Got it. Thank you so much.
So perfect, Deepal.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I think with that, we come to a very, very fruitful, very informative session. Is there any more questions? You can go ahead. Everybody can unmute. I take the silence as no, and I think it's already 9:30 PM. So thank you, Mini. Thank you, Ketan. Well, absolutely a wonderful session, very informative, very fruitful. And all the members, all the participants who are present right now, if you have any query, any further question, please contact me directly. I'll connect you directly with Mini and with Ketan, and they'll be the best person to do the handholding for you. And we hope to have many, many more series of such webinars with both of them. And we're really looking forward for more such, partnership in terms of sharing of knowledge. And any typical question, anything related, questions related to the topic, if you want to be addressed by either Ms. Mini or by Ketanji, please let me know. I'll share you their numbers, and you can eventually connect with them later on. So I think with that, we end our today's session. Mini, Ketan, once again, a big word of thanks on behalf of MSME and Startup Forum Bharat, and looking for many more such webinars with you people. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Priti. Thanks for having us.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you,
Ketan.
Thank you.
Thank you. Likewise. Equal pleasure.
Thank you. Sure. Thank you, Ketan.